Dear ones to Christ and to us, we have a meditation that we use on the wonderful Lord is my shepherd, Psalm 23. And the Lord is my shepherd. The title of shepherd removes all fears from our hearts. There is no one more gentle with his sheep than shepherds. He is with them when they're lambing, when they're birthing their lambs. He is with them when they're lost. He heals them with oil. The Lord is indeed our shepherd. We shall want for nothing. In John chapter 10, the Lord assures us we will go in and out through his gate into green pastures. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall want for nothing. He makes me lie down in these greenest of all pastures. He leads me beside still waters. These are the waters of baptism, dear ones, and the waters of the renewal of the Holy Spirit. As we wash ourselves in prayer after each day, he leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He makes it healthy again with the stillness as he speaks to us. And he leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. After my baptism, I will go forth and bear fruit in paths of righteousness to give glory to the name who has saved me, the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. This is our entire life, dear ones. We have no assurance that the Lord will not allow death to come at any time, as we are ready to see him. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thy rod, the rod of his incarnation, of his incarnate person, the Lord Jesus Christ, the rod which shone forth from the Virgin in the book of Isaiah prophesied, and thy staff, the staff which we see as Moses held up for the healing of the people wounded by the serpents, thy rod and the staff of thy cross shall comfort me. He has prepared for me a banquet in the sight of all my foes. My head he anoints with oil. My head is those who are ahead of me, my husband and my bishop. We have the promise of the Holy Spirit that he will anoint the head of our lives with oil. This includes my own head, as I am soaked in the Holy Spirit gifts that 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans 12 assures me of. All the anointing of the Holy Spirit, symbolized by the oil, runs over. There is abundance upon abundance upon abundance. Psalm 133, even down the beard of Aaron, all parts of the body of Christ are soaked in the wonderful gifts and presence of the Holy Spirit. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Everyone I have met will be covered with his goodness and mercy. Everyone who has done good to me, or even those who have not done good to me. Goodness and mercy shall cover them as I pray for the Lord to be present in past, in my present, and to anticipate my future with him in the joy of the banqueting of the Lord with all of the saints, to glorify him in the Holy Spirit and God the Father. Amen and amen. Who is our God? Who is the one who saves us? Saint John, his beloved apostle, perhaps the one closest to him of all the apostles and disciples, tells us God is love. Now this love means it totally lives for the good of his creation, and his creation of man is above all other creations. So we can trust, dear ones, that everything he has for us, from our past, which is hidden in a mystery of his will, to the present in which I meet him hourly, every minute in prayer, lifting my gaze to him, giving thanks to him for all things. And in the future, I have the promise that we shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord forever and ever. In John chapter 6, toward verse 56 and onward, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood, that is, shares utterly in my deified humanity from the Virgin, shall not die but live. He shall not die. He shall not have death be his final experience. But the resurrection of the dead is His. How is that? It is made possible by the outpoured love by which Christ wants us, His wonderful creation, His new Adam, wants to give birth to those who will come and join in the waters of baptism by which He gives us new birth. John chapter 3, we are a new creation. We have a second birth. The first birth was under old Adam, and we have mortality and death from that Adam. But from the second Adam, 1 Corinthians 15, we have a new creation. He has taken the flesh of the virgin and deified it utterly. We share in this new nature, human nature, deified by Christ and in Him. We share it through energies. So infused into our life are the energies of the great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Energies are just that. They energize us. The apostles travel the whole world in their little human bodies, energized with the fuel of the Holy Spirit from Pentecost, energized with the Word of God. And this we share also. As we share in His precious body and precious blood, each one of our cells is renewed. This is a spiritual as well as physical food. It is not spiritual only. We are made up of body, soul, and spirit. This tells us that as full human persons, we share in the energies of Christ's full humanity. Let us with humility approach Him and ask Him to heal, to restore, and to give grace, for we are poor and have nothing of our own, except our love to give Him and our will by which we are choosing to follow Him. Take up our cross and to follow Him as He leads us into the holy faith, the fullness of the Orthodox faith given from the apostles to us. Amen.
Better to focus on the positive, and in fact I've received so many nice messages and kind messages from Serbians saying that if I want to understand the heart of Serbia, the Serbian soul, then I absolutely have to go to visit the Serbian monasteries for which Kosovo is so famous, and that is exactly what we're going to do.
Oh, right there. Full of faith, had like a spiritual experience in there. So the monastery was constructed by then King of the Serbian Kingdom, Stefan Milutin, in 1321. It was the last monastery to be constructed in the Byzantine style with five domes. There are 4,000 frescoes inside. It is absolutely just, I had a spiritual experience in there. I have to say, this is me as a British person coming. You can understand why Serbians feel that Kosovo is their spiritual heartland when you're in a place like that. Stefan Milutin had promised to pledge to build a church for every year of his reign. He reigned for 40 years back in the 14th century. This was pre-Ottoman Empire. And this church was never destroyed, or in fact, it's still the original building as it was from 1321, from the 14th century. He did build a church, Stefan Milutin, for every year of his 40-year reign, but this is the finest, and here it is, standing to this day in Kosovo and Metohija. And that was incredible. Really incredible.
Another episode of Neither Here Nor in Jerusalem. In this episode, we're visiting Ravanica, which is a very historic monastery from the 14th century. Ravanica was built by Prince Lazar, who is also known as Tsar Lazar. He is a saint, and he's buried in this monastery.
The monastery church is dedicated to the Ascension of Christ. The Ravanica Church is the first monument of the Morava school of Serbian church architecture. Ravanica has been assaulted and damaged many times, the Ottoman Turks being the main aggressors. Between the 14th and 20th centuries, the monastery and its monks suffered at least five times. During World War II, the Germans also attacked, torturing and killing its archimandrite Makarie on the 24th of February, 1943. Thank you. Although Prince Lazar, the builder of this monastery, was never granted the title of Tsar, he is often referred to as Tsar Lazar by the Serbians due to their love for him. After the emperor's death, Lazar was the de facto ruler of Serbia, and as such he managed to heal the schism between the Church of Serbia and Constantinople. They didn't let us take any footage in the church, but here are some pictures from the interior. Here we see a modern yet beautiful icon of Tsar Lazar. He is sitting just above his relics. Unfortunately, his relics were not visible today. The relics of Saint Lazar have been known to perform miracles. To this very day, pilgrims flock here to pray and ask the saint for intercessions. The frescoes are dated between 1385 and 1387, and were worked on by multiple artists.
Another thing about Saint Lazar is that he died in battle against the Turks.
The Battle of Kosovo and the Prince entered into the minds and hearts of all Serbs. Saint Lazar was hailed as a martyr of Christ for being beheaded by the Turks, and his monastery, Ravanica, would be the greatest monument that the Prince would leave behind.
It's something that many monarchs did. Like the ancient Roman pagan emperors would build arcs, the triumphal arcs, basically glorifying themselves. The Christian emperors and kings, princes, etc., built churches dedicated to God, not themselves. Here we can see a statue of Saint Tsar Lazar. This is really neat because it seems like he's pointing to where the monastery is. Anybody who's looking for his monastery, that's the road over there. You follow the way he's pointing.
I hope you all enjoyed this episode of Neither Here Nor in Jerusalem. See you all in the next one.
Blessed is the kingdom of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Amen. Hi, everybody. Today, we are going to Celje on this episode of Neither Here Nor in Jerusalem. Celje is the monastery of Saint Justin Popovic. He went there in the 40s in a sort of exile by the communists, and he died there. And he was the spiritual son of another great theologian, Nikolai Velimirovich. Just to give you an idea, before he died, he said that he wants to be buried at Celje because when the second coming comes and he's resurrected, he wants to be able to look at his monastery one last time.
We set out on foot for Celje on November 1st from the city of Valjevo. The hike would take us about an hour and a half.
No.
We took a well-known shortcut on the railway. Many pilgrims use this route, and since we were in a little bit of a hurry, we used it too. We finally could see Celje. The very sight of it was serene. Celje comes from the Greek word kelia, which is plural for monastic cells.
Did you get that?
Yes, of course.
Excellent. Oh, here we go.
The monastery of Celje has a long history. No one knows the exact date of its founding, but it's estimated to have been built between the 13th and 15th centuries. Its founder is also disputed. Some say it was King Stefan Dragutin. A local legend says that it was three brothers from the Nemanjići royal dynasty, and yet others say it was built by the despot Stefan Lazarević. The new church has three altars, one to St. Sava of Serbia, one to St. Justin the Martyr, and another to St. Mary of Egypt. St. Justin was sent to Celje in 1945 and spent 31 years there until his repose in 1979. During his time there, he was constantly under the surveillance of the communists, but that didn't stop him from writing and creating powerful theological works.
the monastery is dedicated to the archangels Michael and Gabriel. Between the 18th and 20th centuries, the monastery was destroyed and rebuilt many times, the aggressors being mainly the Ottomans, but was also destroyed in World War I and World War II. We weren't certain if they would allow us to take any footage inside the old church, where St. Justin's relics were. When we arrived, a priest whom we knew gave us some hope. He said he would ask for us. It seems we had St. Justin's blessing, and we therefore managed to capture just a few pictures of his reliquary. Next to the church where his relics are is the tomb from where he wanted to rise when the Lord comes again in glory. This tomb was dug illegally. The communists weren't allowing any excavations to be done due to the historic nature of the monastery.
Okay, so we're gonna go get some coffee, and what a blessing it has been to visit Celje. It's an amazing pilgrimage site.
And now I will leave you with a quote by St. Justin. Thank you all for watching this episode of Neither Here Nor in Jerusalem. I'll see you in the next one. In truth, there is only one freedom, the holy freedom of Christ, whereby he freed us from sin, from evil, from the devil. It binds us to God. All other freedoms are illusory. That is to say, they are all, in fact, slavery.